jumping to verse 63. The Spirit gives life. The flesh counts for nothing. The words I have spoken to you, they are full of Spirit and life. Yet there are some of you who do not believe. And then look at what Jesus says next. For Jesus had known from the beginning which of them did not believe and who would betray him. Jesus is saying, I have one here that's with me. He's one of the 12, and he doesn't believe in me. He's here, he's seeing all this, but he doesn't believe in me. You might remember that day that John's talking about. Jesus is saying something, and didn't it sound kind of gross? Eat my body, drink my blood. You gotta eat my flesh. What? I don't want to eat a human being. No, thank you. In fact, it upset the people so much that crowds actually stopped following after Jesus. They're like, okay, this is bad. You might also remember that after Jesus rose from the dead, that one of the criticisms of the church, one of the big criticisms of the church, was they're cannibals. They eat people. Listen to what they say. Every time they gather together and they have bread and they have wine and they say they're going to eat the body and drink the blood. And it was this nasty, nasty belief that people had about Christians. Now, you all know like what that really means, right? It means bread and wine or grape juice or something like that. But no, then we're going to eat the body and drink the blood. Yucko. And the people believed that Christians were cannibals. But the problem was, and so people are like, oh, we're getting away from this. And Jesus, this is weird. And they left him. Judas remains one of the 12. Judas didn't believe. He didn't believe in Jesus. Do you remember what happened when Judas comes to betray Jesus? When he's got the money already. He's bringing the soldiers, or the armed guard, as you should say, from the chief priests. They're coming up, and as they're walking down into the garden where Jesus and the disciples have been praying, you remember what Judas said? Well, Matthew says it this way, going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Now, why is that significant? Because I've already said Judas didn't believe in Jesus. What does he call him? Calls him teacher. Calls him rabbi. Calls him the same term that the chief priests and the people have been arguing with Jesus have used for him. You're a teacher. You're not the Messiah. You're not the anointed one. You're not the holy one. So, greetings, Rabbi. What? This is Jesus. This is the man you've been with for 3 years. Don't you care about him? You're walking up right now to betray him, and you're going to do it with a kiss? Greetings, Rabbi. Do you hear almost the contempt in his voice? Greetings, Rabbi. Judas didn't believe in Jesus. John 12 says, but one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. This is the story we did last week, where Mary anointed Jesus' feet and his head with this expensive perfume. It's a perfume that's normally used for burial. And she spent tons of money, and who knows how long she saved this. And she wastes it according to what? According to Judas. Verse 5 of John 12. Why wasn't this perfume sold? I should back up so I don't skip this for you. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. And, you know, at first thought, you know, yeah. And some of the other disciples, yeah. I mean, we're supposed to be taking care of the poor. We're not supposed to be wasting money on perfume. Yeah, why wasn't it given away? And then John goes on. He did not say this because he cared about the poor. But he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. He didn't believe in Jesus. You know, Jesus knew Judas very well. John 13, the evening meal was in progress, and the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Verse 11 says, for he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said, not everyone was clean. Not everyone's clean. Not everyone believes. He knows Judas. Think about how much he did to try to connect to Judas. He called him as one of his disciples. I mean, wouldn't you like to have been one of those 12? I'm calling you to be a disciple. I mean, calling you to be one of the 12, one of the special ones. You're going to get to heal sick, cast out demons. You're going to have all kinds of fun things you're going to experience. We're going to go win the world together. You're one of the disciples. Wouldn't you have liked to have been one of them? You just wanted to be one of the good ones, not the bad one, right? He calls him as one of the disciples. He invites him to watch from him and learn from him. He actually, with each of the other 12, he actually even anoints him to be able to do miracles. In fact, Jesus even said, you know what? People throughout the ages have wanted to see what you see, men. They wanted to experience what you're experiencing with me. They've prayed for this. They've hoped for this. The prophets have declared messages about this. Only you're the ones getting to see it. And in that same discussion, he will go on and say that there are people who saw but didn't believe. Well, Jesus does what? On the night that Judas is going to betray him, He's breaking this meal with them, this meal that has been provided. They're up in this room that's been provided for them. It's a huge room, by the way. In fact, I meant to show a picture, and I apologize. I forgot to throw it into the PowerPoint this morning. But it's an amazing place, and up in this upper room, literally upstairs and all, and a big, gigantic stone room. And there was, and you have to note, it wasn't just Jesus and the disciples that were probably in that room. I know the paintings all show it as just the 12. However, there were women and other people that were there, and that's why even in our discussion in Mark says what? I'm telling you, one of you is going to betray me. And everyone in the room is like, is it I? And he says, no, it's one of the 12. Why did he have to emphasize one of the 12? Because there's more than 12 people there in the room. And then he even goes on and he says, it's the one who's actually reaching down and taking the bread and dipping in the same bowl with me. John says that when Peter says, John, find out who it is. Because John's laying right next to him on the right side, the best place. And Judas is on the left side. Not such a good place. Because Judas is behind him. Jesus is behind John. And Peter says to John, find out who it is. And Jesus tells John, it's the one I'm dipping bread with right now. And he dips the bread and shares it with Judas behind him. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to the man who betrays him. They began to question among themselves which of them it might be who would do this. And a dispute arose among them as to which one of them was considered to be the greatest. You see why the disciples missed it? They first off do the very selfish, is it he? Is it me? Am I the one? And then like, no, because I'm more important than you. And they get into this battle and discussion about that. It's interesting. He washes Judas's feet. I have a feeling that right now, if I brought out water and came to you, some of you would be uncomfortable. I don't know if I want you washing my feet, Pastor Bill. And I'm just Pastor Bill. But Jesus, kneeling at your feet, washing your feet, he washed the feet of Judas. He breaks the bread. John says, now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I've set you an example that you should do as I have done for you. This is John 13. Very truly, I tell you, no servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. I'm not referring to all of you. Uh-oh. I know those I have chosen, but this is to fulfill this passage of Scripture. He who shared my bread is turned against me. I'm telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe that I am who I am. He just used the name of God. Very truly I tell you, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me. Whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, very truly I tell you, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples stared at one another at a loss to know which of them he meant. One of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. Leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, is the one whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot. And as soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. So Jesus told him, what you're about to do, do quickly. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed for the festival or to give something to the poor. As soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. Just think about that for a minute. Jesus gave him the bread. He said, I'm the bread of life, right? He just broke the bread. He said, this is my body broken for you. He's saying this to all the disciples, but he is so close that he could actually practically touch the face of Judas as he's saying this with his face. I am the bread of life. And he gives Judas the bread. And Judas eats it. As soon as he was done eating the bread, Judas leaves. So why did Judas betray Jesus? Well, number one, I've said he didn't believe in him. Second reason, it was a fulfillment of prophecy. Zechariah chapter 11, verse 12. I told them, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if not, keep it. So they paid me 30 pieces of silver. John Harvey says, first fact is it was a fulfillment of prophecy. The second fact, Satan put the plan in his heart. What did I just read? After he ate the bread, Satan entered into him. Judas was a man probably blinded by his own passions. He's the one who was a zealot. He's a businessman, a professional man. He's the one man who's not from Galilee. He's actually a well-trained man, unlike the rest of the disciples, all things that probably didn't help him. He didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah, and when you don't believe, you become a greater unbeliever. How did Jesus say it? I speak to them in parables, and this is why. Though seeing, they do not see. Though hearing, they do not hear or understand. In them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. You will be ever hearing, but never understanding. You will be ever seeing, but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. He took the bread. He ate it, and he left the room. Wouldn't you have liked to have been there to watch Jesus do this? Judas was there. He's watching it all. He's even eating this bread, this message from Jesus, and what does he do? He leaves the room because Satan has entered his life. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered in him. So Jesus told him, what are you about to do? Do quickly. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. But Judas did. I have another question that goes along with this. Why did Judas kiss Jesus? First off, did they really need it? I mean, did they really need Judas? Couldn't they have just have come and gotten Jesus? I think. Why did he need to kiss him? Back to our text. Then Judas Iscariot, verse 10, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money. So he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. Judas is taking control, isn't he? While they were, verse 18, while they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. The Son of Man," verse 21, "will go just as it is written about him, but woe to the man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." And then jump ahead to verse 44. "Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them, 'The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard.'" In Luke 22, "But the hand of him who is going to betray me is with mine on the table. The Son of Man will go as it has been decreed, but woe to that man who betrays him." In verse 48, "But Jesus asked him, 'Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?'" Why with a kiss? Well, let's be nice. First off, what's the normal way you greet anybody in the East? You come up, you go on the side, right? We all have seen those kinds of kisses, like they never touch, right? I'm sorry, it seems comical to me. Okay, we go, we're going to kiss somebody. I mean, if I'm going to kiss Debbie, I'm not going to kiss the air on the left and the right side of her ear. I'd rather kiss her ear or her cheek or her lips, but just kiss the air. But that's the kind of the greeting, right? You have to learn to do that if you're ever going to go to the Middle East, okay, or anywhere in the East. You know, yeah, learn how to kiss the air on the other side. So it's a normal way of greeting in the East. But I think there's something more to it, and I think it's sad. Judas's betrayal is personal. It's a personal rejection of Jesus Christ. And so he comes up. Step into his space and give him a kiss. There. You're not my Messiah. And how did Jesus say it? The last thing. Satan was ruling the heart of Judas. And you know, pause with that one for a minute. Why would Satan have Judas betray Jesus if that would mean Jesus would get killed? Does Satan want Jesus to die? He doesn't. He doesn't want it. Because if Jesus dies, what happens? The perfect Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. Satan's not wanting that to happen. What is he really wanting? He's wanting to incite the riot that they've already been afraid of. He knows that these disciples have swords with them, or at least a couple. What happens? Peter grabs one of the swords, takes it out, cuts off the servant's ear. He wants a fight because he knows if there's a fight that will happen, Jesus will not die, and therefore he wins. So he sends the betrayer with a mob of soldiers. And he wants Jesus to live. He even thinks, okay, we'll take him back to town and we'll get people all upset and they'll stop this. There will be a riot and Jesus won't die. Satan has entered into Judas and Judas falls for Satan's plan. All right, another tough question. This one's one that gets asked a lot. Did Jesus forgive Judas? Did Jesus forgive Judas? Matthew 26, verse 24. "The Son of Man will go just as it is written about him. But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born." That doesn't sound like a good thing, does it? Then Judas, the one who would betray him, said, "Surely you don't mean me, Rabbi." Oh my goodness, again, this attitude. Jesus answered, "You have said so." Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. I've now jumped to verse 48. Matthew 27. When Judas, who had betrayed him, saw that Jesus was condemned, he was seized with remorse and returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders. I have sinned, he said, for I have betrayed innocent blood. What is that to us? They replied. That's your responsibility. Judas, do you see it? This guy that's, you know, like, you know, well, I'm not going to betray you, am I? I mean, there's just kind of an evil attitude in him, a cynical mindset, a non-believing part of him. And yet what happens after Jesus is arrested? Judas is broken. He takes the money that he got, and this is a guy that's been so greedy, he's been taking money right out of the offering bag. The money that's supposed to be given to the poor, the money that's been supposed to take care of the disciples, he's been stealing from it all the time, skimming from the top. Ushers, watch out. You're not supposed to take money off the plate for you, okay? Judas has been doing that. And here's the sad thing. Not only is he broken, and he does admit his sin, but here's the sad one. Judas never comes to Jesus. Judas never accepts Jesus' love. And he never allows Jesus to reconcile with him. Colossians says, the Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of over all creation. In him all things were created, things in heaven, on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have his fullness dwell in him and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Did Jesus forgive him? It's one of his last words on the cross. I had it in the video we showed you earlier. Did you hear what he said? Luke 23, verse 34. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. Earlier, Jesus said, Mark 11, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. Did Jesus forgive Judas? Yes. Yes. But Judas hung himself. The tragedy of that is so horrific. Because with all the things prophesied about him, because of all the things that he had done, even his lack of belief in faith in Jesus Christ, even this coming and kissing him on the cheek and rejecting him right there, all of that, Jesus forgave him. But Judas cannot accept the reconciliation bought and paid for with the blood on that. Well, I have two questions for you. I know there may have been a few of them this morning, but these are even more personal. How have you betrayed Jesus?
Well, I didn't get any 30 pieces of silver. I didn't go to the high priest. Jesus already died. How have you betrayed Jesus Christ? Did you hear how I started the message this morning? All sin is a betrayal of Christ. How have you betrayed the one who loved you unconditionally? And the second one I need to ask, because it's very probable that people in this room have been betrayed and hurt deep ways. And I've got to ask you, have you forgiven your betrayer? Have you forgiven the one who hurt you? The one who rejected you? And I guess if you think about it, if I can't forgive someone else, then am I not betraying Jesus, who forgave everyone? All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and he has now given us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. Jesus, some of us have consciously chosen to betray you. We've made choices that went completely against your desire for us, your will for us, your love for us. God, you called Israel you called her a whore. You said she committed adultery against you by worshiping other gods. Lord, we're almost disgusted with Judas, who would actually go up and kiss you on the cheek and then turn from you. But God, your word says that worship, the very word for worship is to kiss God. We come to worship. We kiss you. And then we leave and go and sin. God, we're not unlike Judas. So cleanse and forgive us. And help us, Jesus, to not run and hang ourselves in shame, but to run to you and allow you to reconcile us, to make us new, through the gift of your blood and your forgiveness. Help us this week, God, to actually question ourselves, to examine ourselves and see where we may be betraying you. And teach us more about forgiveness. In Jesus' name.